William Morrow and Harper Audio present Shards of a Broken Crown, Book 4 of the Serpentwar Saga by Raymond E. Feist. Performed by Peter Joyce.
Prologue. The general knocked.
Enter,
said the self-styled king of the Bitter Sea, as he looked up from a hastily scribbled note just handed him by his captain of intelligence, Cahil. General Norden entered and shook off the snow from his cloak.
You found us a cold land to rule, Majesty,
he said with a smile. He gave Cahil the briefest nod of greeting. Fadua, former commanding general of the Army of the Emerald Queen, now ruler of the city of Illith and the surrounding countryside, said,
At least it's a cold land with food and firewood.
He waved in a vague fashion to the south.
We're still getting stragglers in from as far away as Darkmoor, who paint a bleak picture about conditions throughout the Western Realm.
Norden motioned to a chair, and Fadua nodded. While old companions, they observed the formalities as Fadua prepared to launch his spring campaign. The general still wore the ritual scars on his cheeks, marks given him when swearing loyalty to the Pantathians. He had considered attempting to find a witch or healing priest who could remove them, for when he had finally realized that the Pantathians were as much dupes as he was, he had killed their remaining high priest. As far as Fadua was concerned, he was no longer bound to anyone. He was his own man, and he was in a rich land with an army. But Cahil had reminded him the scars were intimidating and kept the men in awe of him. Cahil had served the Emerald Queen before she had been destroyed by the demon, but he had proven a valuable and trusted advisor since the change in leadership of the invading army. By last count, over 30,000 men had found their way into the south end of the province of Yabon. He had organized them, stationed them, and now controlled all the lands from Illith, south past Questor's View, north to the outskirts of Zun, west to the city of Natal, which was now occupied by more of his own men than their own pitiful defenses. He had also captured Hawk's Hollow, a small town, but one giving him control of a vital pass through the mountains to the east.
Some of the men don't like the idea of staying, said Norden.
The stocky soldier rubbed his bearded chin and cleared his throat.
They're talking of finding a ship and going back across the sea.
To what?
Asked Fadua.
To a land burned out and overrun by barbarians from the grasslands? Besides the dwarven stronghold in the Ratangari Mountains and some surviving Jeshandi in the north, what is there left of civilization? Did we leave a city standing? Is there anything there to support us?
Fadua scratched his head. He wore a single long fall of hair and shaved the rest of his head, another sign of his devotion to the Emerald Queen's dark powers.
Tell any of the men who are talking this way that come spring, if they can find a ship and take it, they're free to leave.
He looked off into space, as if seeing something in the air.
I want no one here who isn't ready to serve me. We're going to have a serious fight on our hands.
The kingdom?
Fadua said.
You don't think they're going to sit idly by and not attempt to regain their lands, do you?
No, but they were terribly mauled at Krondor and Darkmoor. The prisoners tell us they don't have much of an army left to put in the field.
Fadua said, If they don't bring their army of the east over from Darkmoor, true.
But if they do, we need to be ready.
Well, said Norden, we won't know until spring.
That's only another 3 months, said Fadua. We need to be prepared.
You have a plan?
Always, said the wily old general. I don't want a two-front war if I can help it. If I was stupid, I could find myself in a forefront war.
He indicated a map on the wall of the room. They were currently occupying the estate house of the Earl of Illith, dead by all reports, along with the Duke of Yabon and the Earl of Lamut.
If our information is right, we face a boy up in Lamut.
He rubbed his chin.
We need to take Lamut as soon as the spring thaw begins, and I want Yabon in our grasp by midsummer.
He smiled.
Send a message to the leader in Natal.
He turned to Cahill.
What's his title?
The First Counselor,
supplied his captain of intelligence.
Send the First Counselor our thanks for his hospitality in providing billets for our men this winter, and send him some gold. 1,000 pieces should do.
1,000? Asked Norden.
We have it, and we'll get more. Then withdraw our men and bring them here.
He looked at his old friend.
That will at least keep the First Counselor on our good side. Until we return to Natal, take and keep it.
He pointed to the map.
I want Duco and his men down in Krondor by then.
Norden raised an eyebrow in curiosity. Fadoa said,
Duco makes me uneasy. He's an ambitious man.
He frowned.
It was only chance that put you and me first and second on the Pantathians' rolls. Else we could be taking orders from Duco.
Norden nodded.
But he's a good leader, and he's always obeyed without question.
That he is, which is why I want him at the front. I want you down behind him in Sarth.
But why Krondor?
Norden shook his head.
There's nothing there.
But there will be, said Fadoa.
That's their western capital, their prince's city, and they will move back there as quickly as they can.
He nodded to himself.
If Duco can keep them busy until we seize all of Yabon, then we can turn our sights on the free cities, this far coast region.
He pointed to the western coast of the kingdom.
We'll reoccupy Krondor and move back toward the old battle line.
What's that place?
Nightmare Ridge.
Well named.
Fadoa sighed.
I'm not a greedy man. Being king of the Bitter Sea is enough. We'll let the Kingdom of the Isles keep their Darkmoor and the lands to the east.
Then he smiled.
For now?
But first we must retake Krondor.
Fadoa said,
No. First we must make them think we want to retake Krondor. These kingdom nobles are not stupid. They are not self-consumed like those of our homeland.
He remembered how shocked the priest-king of Lenarda had been when Fadoa and his army had refused to heed his order to leave his city.
These are smart men, duty-bound men. They will come at us, and they will come hard. We must expect that.
No. Let them think Krondor is the prize. And when they realize we are firm in Yabon, perhaps they will negotiate, or perhaps not. But either way, once we have control of Yabon, we are here for good. Let Duco get punished, lest he become ambitious.
Norden stood.
If you permit, I'll tell the men those who wish to leave in the spring may.
Fadoa waved his permission.
Majesty, said Norden,
leaving Fadoa alone with Cahill. To Cahill, Fadoa said,
Wait, then follow Norden and see who he speaks with. Mark the men who are the leaders of these dissidents. They will have accidents before the thaw, and then we can put to rest this nonsense about returning to Norvindus.
Of course, Majesty, said the captain of intelligence, and I applaud your design in putting Norden down in Sarth.
Fadoa said,
Design?
Cahill leaned over, putting his arm around Fadoa's shoulder, and he whispered,
Put all your disloyal commanders to the south, to ensure that when the enemy exacts their price for our conquest, those we can most afford to lose pay it.
Fadua's eyes became unfocused, as if he was listening to something in the distance.
Yes, that is wise.
Cahil said, you need to surround yourself with those who can be trusted, those who are loyal beyond a doubt. You need to return the immortals to a place of prominence.
No, said Fadua. Those madmen serve dark powers.
Cahil interrupted.
Not dark powers, Majesty, but vast powers. Powers that can ensure your rule not only in Yabon, but in Krondor, too.
Krondor? Asked Fadua.
Cahil clapped his hands twice, and the door swung open. Two warriors, each with ritual scars on his cheeks that matched Fadua's, entered, and Cahil said,
Guard the king with your lives.
Fadua repeated,
Krondor.
Cahil rose and departed, closing the door behind him. A faint smile passed across his face before he turned and left upon his next task, following Nordan and marking those men for death who displayed even the smallest hint of disloyalty. Fadua looked at the two soldiers and motioned for them to stand away from him. The scars on their faces reminded him of the dark and distant time he was caught up in the magic of the Emerald Queen, and the lost months when the demon had ruled her army. He hated feeling used, and would kill anyone who again attempted to use him as the Emerald Queen had. He moved to the map on the wall and began to plan his spring campaign. Chapter 1. Winter. The wind had died. Dash waited. The frigid bite of the air still brought tears to his eyes as he scanned the road below. The reconstruction of Darkmoor had been tedious, slowed by continuous snows and rain, as the winter proved a fickle one. If slippery ice wasn't making footing treacherous for those workmen attempting to rebuild the walls around the western portion of the city, then knee-deep mud-stalled wagons carrying needed supplies did. Now it was icy again, but at least Dash was thankful there was currently no snow. The sky was clear, the late afternoon sun hinting at warmth that wasn't really there. Dash knew it was his mood as much as the weather, but this particular winter seemed to have lasted longer than any in his young life. The sounds of the city carried through the still, icy air as the day wound down. With luck, the new gate would be finished before sunset, and an extra modicum of security would be added to the sum of things that needed to be done yesterday. Dash was tired, fatigued beyond anything he could remember in his 20 years of life. Part of it was from the seemingly endless list of things that needed attention, and the rest was from worry. His brother Jimmy was overdue. Jimmy was acting the part of exploring officer, a scout behind enemy lines. Prince Patrick of Krondor had decided to move hard and fast against a threat of Keshian expansion into the southern flank of the kingdom in the spring. That meant that the retaking of lands lost during the invasion the previous summer would be left to Owen Greylock, Knight Marshal of Krondor, and Eric von Darkmoor, Knight Captain of the Crimson Eagles, an elite, mobile force of hand-picked men, which had meant the prince needed information on what the invaders were doing between Darkmoor and Krondor, and Jimmy had volunteered to go see what was going on. He was now 3 days overdue. Dash had come to the edge of the patrolled area, a series of burned-out walls that marked the western edge of the Foulberg of Darkmoor. The prince's army in the city ensured that there was little danger within a day's ride of the city, but these partial walls and piles of tumbled masonry provided ample cover for ambush, and had been refuge to more than one band of scavengers or outlaws. Dash scanned the horizon, watching for his brother. The sounds of the winter woodlands below...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.